You just back up to a thing to stop.
Our discussion is on the comp plan.
Yes, sir.
And I would like you to explain the significance as well as the requirements, timeline, et cetera.
Yes, sir.
And the importance of how it impacts these other issues.
What Paige has given you is three documents. One is just the rules that the Department of Community Affairs uses when they evaluate our plans. The other document is kind of the most current update of our existing plan. And then the last document is so far the first draft of the next update of the plan. Now, I don't think there's, I don't want to spend much time on why planning is important and why we're here. I feel like y'all understand that and you do a good job of planning in your own right, which I'm very thankful for. I think one of the chairman's newest initiatives to have a community meeting, I think, is something that is a hallmark and really a firework for good for the community to show what you can do when you get together and make sure we're all on the same page. So beyond that, why we are here is really the Department of Community Affairs once every 5 years requires you to do an update of your plan. Now, those updates come in two forms. One form is kind of a minor update, one form is a major update. We did our minor update in the last 5 year cycle, so this is the major updates term. What you're gonna have the opportunity to work on and update is something that has not been comprehensively updated since 2006 and 2007. So you can see there have been changes in our community and changes in the commission and changes in the priorities that you're going to have the opportunity to impact. So this year is the year for a major update to that comprehensive plan. Why this year is because every 10 years DCA requires this major update, but ultimately at your discretion you can update this comprehensive plan at any time. But with that, that's kind of why the timelines and why we have this. DCA says this is the year, this is the major update. To me, what you're going to see as we get into some of the timelines that I just want to share with you are the Regional Commission is helping us update this comprehensive plan. They really break things down into three main sections. They break it down into an issues, opportunities, and goals section. They break it down into what's called a short-term work program and report of accomplishments. And they break it down into land use. So throughout the next probably 6 months, you'll be seeing different advertisements of workshops on those various topics. You don't have to attend the workshop if you want to have input on that, but it's a general opportunity for the general public and also anyone else to come here and actually have public input on those sections. At any time, you can meet with any of us and our staff, as well as the Regional Commission staff, and go through any numerous questions you'd like, provide directions. So don't feel like your direction is specifically tailored to, okay, we only accept input on goals at this time. We only accept input on land use at this time. Really, for the next 3 to 4 months, it's going to be an open opportunity to provide input on these sections. But typically, what they'd like to do is try to have the plan submitted to DCA probably mid-summer, so that DCA has an opportunity to review it, provide any comments they have, and then set it on your schedule for later in the early fall, probably, for your consideration and final adoption. Ultimately, the motivation behind this, not only do you want a plan that reflects your current priorities and sets some direction for at least the next 5 to 10 years, but also, where the rubber meets the road for DCA is if we don't agree to their timelines, they start threatening to withhold some of our funding from the state. So really, we've never had to go that far, but generally, that's the kind of teeth that DCA and skin that DCA has in this game is eventually, if you don't comply with their requirements and their timing, they start to draw down some of the funding you get from the grants we work with, or the transportation funds we get. So ultimately, that's the kind of rubber meets the road. But we normally don't press up against that. We have our timelines planned out to be well ahead of that. And at the end of the day, I know you have a lot of documentation there as far as rules and drafts, and that's fine, well and good. But there's one slide in there that pertains to specific timelines for the rest of the year. And I'd just like you to flip to that slide. Okay, is it after our current
comp plan update tab?
Yes.
Which is the first page behind the comp plan update tab?
It's one page that gives you, that was it, sir. It's one page, 2016, it has some dates on it. To me, These are the dates for the rest of the year. They're not set in stone, but they're certainly something we're working with. Our general motivation is to try to pull in the Planning Commission, utilize their perspective and also their work sessions as a natural host for these meetings. Depending on the turnout and the response, we may have to shift the time or the location. But generally, those are the particular dates and the topics that we're planning on focusing on the rest of the year. So with that, to me, I'll try to answer any questions you might have. But generally, that's the overview. And really, the input portion of this plan is really going to try to happen before that June, July commission deadline. Why that's important is because that's when we're going to send our first draft to DCA.
Jason, talk about the February 22nd meeting.
Sure.
What you anticipate coming out of the issues for
we have in our both plans that you have are kind of mirror images of the goals and issues and opportunities that we had 5 years ago, 10 years ago. To me, one of the most significant things to be done since that time is through the regional commission, we work with a document that was called a Common Community Vision. Where one of the things that document did is they went out and surveyed all of the plans in the community, as far as I know, except for one, and that was Parks and Recreation. So we need to dovetail Parks and Rec in there. But they surveyed out the hospital, DSU, various nonprofit agencies, and schools. And they tried to say, okay, what does everyone's goals look like? Are there common forms? Are there things we're differing? And they tried to boil all those goals down into a kind of one document, one set of goals, one set of vision, one vision. And so to me, that's been the most significant update we've had. I don't know if you have recent copies of that document. I'd be happy to send one out. But certainly, in my opinion, I know Mr. Pritchard would say, you know, Jason, you received a lot. But it's one of the best things that I think the Regional Commission has done in about 5 years for that. And so they really did a good job going out amongst the community and looking at, you know, I'd say at least a dozen other plans and saying, where are we together? Where are we different? So the main change that I expect is I think the goals that you have currently in your document, it's my motivation to kind of say, look, those are good, they were good at the time, but right now we think we've got a better product to offer that kind of uses more of the community rather than just saying, what about the local government focus? And I think it's going to be a good thing. So that is one change I expect to happen at that meeting. Otherwise, I think the purpose of the meeting, honestly, for the regional commission, is just to obtain feedback and just offer the community, the public community, an opportunity to come and voice their opinion and their perspective on it. So the main change from a planning standpoint that I expect is to utilize that common community vision document and some of the research they did. And then I also expect just to honestly hear from the public. Certainly y'all are welcome. I think your input is welcome. But I think the target audience is probably the general public, and hearing from some of those individuals who might not have a retreat and the opportunities that we have to communicate back to them.
The greatest advantage for you is probably observing and not participating as far as spokesperson or someone to speak. But to hear and get a gist of those items that are important. Jason, talk for a second about how this is significant. In other words, we have a comp plan. In a lot of situations, comp plans go on the shelf and you don't pull them back down until it's time to do it again. In something new. Explain a little bit about why that is so significant. And more so than it has been in the past.
Sure, and I think most importantly is I believe our community is at a point where y'all recognize the need for coordinating and setting direction. And not only is that important from a staff level to set the direction and coordinate the direction of staff and our resources, but also at a community level. There are places where we can partner up, like the VSU Health Sciences Building, where y'all saw firsthand what happens when the city, the county, when the Air Force Base, and representatives from the hospital and DSU came together for a common vision and saw what results that had. So to me, those type of projects and that type of direction is, I think, what the comprehensive plan is aimed at driving. Not only is it setting a direction for the overall community, potentially coordinating some of those resources or high-level projects, it also is a document that we use every month to evaluate some of the rezoning cases that honestly are so loaded when they get to y'all's meetings. these are the criteria, these are the general directions that we use when we try to ferret out what cases are we going to support, where we feel like the conditions, where we feel like a denial is working. So this plan, not only is it used, you know, just about every month on some of those controversial cases that y'all get served up, but also it's also a general direction-setting document for the entire community. And y'all's opportunity, especially as the county government, is to look at those places where there might be opportunities to partner with other governments or other organizations to go in the direction that the county believes is where this community needs to go. So certainly, while I can't stress enough that it's something you could update tomorrow if you wanted to, the natural opportunity this year hasn't been in the community in 10 years.
And I'm not sure how many of you have had the opportunity to read the documents. But for instance, you asked me about describing the role of our utility versus some of the municipal utilities and partnering for the general benefit of the community. That is addressed in the, it was encouraged and stated at that time for those growing communities, particularly it was referencing Lake Park, because they were, Hayhara was already ahead at that time on preparing and developing their own wastewater treatment facility. But those are the kind of things that it forces you to begin to look at long-range problems, long-range issues, long-range opportunities, which can be influenced or can, this document can influence the potential funding from state sources if they go back and say, it really wasn't in your company, y'all were not looking at doing this. Is there a chance? That doesn't mean it's not going to be funded, but it certainly helps
when you show that you plan to
when you're able to demonstrate to a potential funding source at the state that this is something the community has thought about, has worked through, has had discussions at various levels of other elected officials or entities, and it gives a broader scope for that funding agency to say this is something that the community wants to do and has given credence to.
Yes, sir. No. The other the carrot rather than the stick approach is certainly they try to encourage grant funding to tie in with noticeable priorities that are mentioned in your comp plan. So far, we've done, I think, a very satisfactory job of making sure that we are covered with what grant opportunities we have, what properties or what potential opportunities we have coming up that we make sure we're set up for. But that certainly is part of the carrot from DCA standpoint, is to put potential financial consideration there. If you do a good job of representing the direction that the community should go.
It really is the broadest approach for you to evaluate where you believe the community wants and needs to be in the next 10 years. Because so many of the objects that you deal with or the topics you deal with daily and monthly basis are just immediate issues that are in your face. This gives you the opportunity to really look long range and think about that, the kind of community we want to be. That has been evident in the development of Lowndes County, Valdosta, and other cities because of where we are in comparison to some other communities our size. The planning has been, or is evident, that we have taken those steps. The MAZ is a prime example of that in giving the commissioners at that time in the community an opportunity to evaluate and take action on developing and protecting that area around the meeting. So these meetings are important, but it is really important to for you to give serious consideration and from your input standpoint as to what your vision is, not only for your district specifically, but for the county as a whole. And I think that it's a heavy obligation that you have as a commissioner that will be one of the most long-range influences that you will be able to make as an individual commissioner. Do y'all have any questions about it? I mean, Scotty, I know you have seen some impact on this from ZBOA. The chairman has been on the planning commission, various leadership roles that all of you have played. Any comments from any of
them? Jason's done a good job of kind of giving us an overview today, and then your comments certainly I agree with. And Jason and I have had conversations over the past couple of weeks about the importance of this and just how important it is overall to our entire community. Like I said, not just, I tend to want to look just at, the north side of my district, and I know that we have a lot of growth there. But overall, what effect does this have on the county? But I think the one thing that I'm struggling with is how do we need to make sure that the stakeholders involved in this, being some of the development community, the real estate community, how do we ensure that we get those people there to speak and to be part of this? And how do we get the word out that this is going on? And I know that you and Ariel both have sent emails, and I've tried to forward those to people, but I think we each need to make a conscious effort to say, hey, this is going on, this is important, this is what long-term effects it will have on our community. Come be part of this.
I would agree with that. Simply because I know how my involvement initially got started, and that was through the Home Builders Association and that relationship there.
Yeah.
When the comp plan was being developed, we felt like that it was important enough that the construction industry, the home building industry, at least felt like we were a stakeholder, we needed to be a part of it. And we were. And so they were at the table, you might say, and as it was being developed and had their input. And so I think, again, from leading on to what you said, I think it's going to be extremely important for us as commissioners to go into these different areas and let the business people and developers and property owners of all kinds, let them be aware. Say, listen, this is something you really need to pay attention to, and you need to be a part of it, and go there and contribute. Because again, it can change, but we're going to set the direction that we're looking for the county as a whole to be at to continue.
It's subject to change as factors come about. Mm-hmm. For instance, if economic development an entity comes in. So it can be changed, but it gives you that mold, that concept of what you want to do. And while I encourage y'all to look at those stakeholders, I would, as the chairman alluded to, those stakeholders are every citizen that you represent. Whether it's those citizens that are impacted by, as we met yesterday, the potential transit system, transportation impact of roads coming through particular areas, where economic development takes place, as far as our parks that are designated areas, where you look at providing water and sewer services in the unincorporated area. All of those are an added layer to this big picture.
Joe, I'm glad you brought that up, because I was thinking along the lines of the conversations about fire service, full stations, out in those rural areas. But the question I have for you, Jason, I know in the past, we heard rumors of it was a time that, some of the previous leadership didn't want big businesses here. And I know we were evolved from that time frame, and we're really getting businesses here, and I know it's common to put having more businesses in here, economic development, but is there any specific wording or terminology we need to be aware of as we move forward to gain even more economic development and big businesses here that can retain the youth?
Commissioner, I think it's a good question. And right now, I don't know of a hurdle that we have where, for example, like the development authority has come to us and said, hey, this is something we need y'all to be a little more flexible on. I think Project Max is probably a good example of how, you know, that, if you look on a map, that was in our plans, but there was certainly land there that seemed to lend itself toward industrial development, but only until we had a particular, particular company be interested in that land that really get activated. And then, you know, the county moved very quickly, acted the commission to try to hustle and, make sure that we were doing our job and our research to make sure that the project, that if it worked, it would work. But, Commissioner, I don't know of a specific aspect in this plan other than trying to make sure that not only are we reflective of a business-friendly climate, but also the quality community climate. I think there's a good balance there between those two to make sure that we're trying to accommodate not only for economic development, but also for our quality of life here in the community. So I think as long as you kind of keep growing those balances, which I think we have been, then I think we're going to continue to get, to me, the gifts that are now starting to really come to the forefront of some of the work that the Development Authority has been doing for potentially a couple of years. And not only them, but if you look at the other agencies involved, like when you all make decisions about investing in water and sewer, one of the things, again, to look back on that very large prospect that I really hope will be successful is you look at, not only the county government's investment in water and sewer, but you look at rail, you look at gas, you look at the state's investment in infrastructure out there. So to me, there's probably four or five agencies that made conscious decisions to say this area is just going to be ready, that really came through and hopefully landing a very large industry for the area. So I don't know if I can say, sir, I think you should change this word from shall to may or something that specific. But I can tell you, I think the overall climate, I think, is really the most important. And making sure that our reputation as a community is something that is attractive to the businesses that we want here. And making sure that climate through this plan is properly reflected. Because while they may come and visit our community, before they get here, they're probably looking at these documents and looking at our resources and our website and our map before they're making calls and actually investing their time to actually take a visit. So this is one of those documents that's a front door, let me look at what you're doing before I come and really decide to invest in the community. So I think the climate is an important focus to make sure that this document represents the image and the climate that we want to portray at Peapod South.
I think also we possibly got to look at some of the goal statements in regards to what we want Lowndes County to do. Meaning, I remember seeing one of the goals initially saying to market Lowndes County as a retirement community. Mm-hmm. Well, when you're thinking about jobs and when a business is talking about putting people to work, are they going to go to a retirement community? Yes. I mean, it's only so much. I mean, they don't really have the workforce, retirees.
And to reflect back a little bit about why that was a goal, this was at a time when there was a movement of individuals out of Florida because of hurricanes, et cetera, and the expenses and so forth. And retirees were viewed, and still are, but at that time probably more so, as an industry that enhances and causes you to have a more diverse medical community, which again is expansion of an industry. They had disposable income. They did not heavily impact your school system, but they did broaden your tax base. So those were the kind of items that led that to be more of an issue. But as the economy flipped, then there was more emphasis, as you just pointed out, What about jobs? What about job creation? What about keeping people here as opposed to the retirees? So I don't think it can be an either or. It is just an aspect that we need to be aware of, that that is a possibility, but you can't overlook one aspect of it.
I think it all really just goes back to the issue of what we're talking about is the extreme importance of doing everything that we can to make sure that the different stakeholders are involved in these discussions that has anything to do with growth. And be sure that they're there at the table, because you want to know what that input is. You want to know what it's about. The folks that are driving, let's say, retirement communities, that was 10 years ago, as Mr. Pritchard said. Today, that their interest may have changed, and they want to go maybe into another direction, a different focus.
Sure.
So again, it's very, very important that we get all the stakeholders to understand the importance of attending these meetings, and that they be there so that they can have that input and help drive the ball with their interest.
I think she would remember back the trip from hometown program was a chamber initiative that played an impact in that retiree concept, carried the weight that it did.
As Jason said, we're looking at a good balance. That's what really makes a healthy community, a good balance of economic development and a good balance for, you know, quality of life in that community. You've got to have that balance. And again, it's just extremely important that anybody that has an interest in it or has a stake in it attend these meetings and be a part of that discussion and help move us forward so that we, again, at the end, when we get ready to adopt this, we've got a good document that's going to basically set that mold again, as Mr. Pritchard said, for Lowndes County and give us that direction we want to go in.
One thing that this also does when you look at it, it forces you to consider how a project that you consider worthwhile would be funded. So, I mean, it takes you to that point where it's something that should come from general fund. It also forces you to look at what is the most impactful, what is the best advantage for the taxpayers if it is provision of a service by an intergovernmental agreement between two entities, county and a city, or something else. Jason's comment about quality of life, recreation, what are we doing to overall improve our community. The chairman and I were meeting a couple of weeks ago with a potential prospect. It was, what about the quality of life you have here from having an art center, symphony, university, recreation, agriculture, all of those aspects that make up who we are play an important part in that discussion. Including the medical and retail. So you can't, as the chairman said, overlook one aspect. I know we can perhaps repeat ourselves, but it is just extremely important. It can't be left to someone else to form this concept and bring it to you and you go, no, I have no idea how they got there. What were they thinking? So to understand that, you have to be a participant in hearing of these individuals.
I'm sure this is with you, Jason. I know there's so many Lowndes County that we really don't know what the consequence of what it is. Mm-hmm. And I think at some point we really need to get the RSA down to something that's immediate to explain this. Several years ago, I did a conference with the Green Plus Ministers.
picture, like a photograph that Paige might take of, here's a good picture of our community. Do we want to make sure this picture includes everything, all the issues, all the good things, all the bad things, that we know what's going on. Here's a good picture of what's happening right now. The second picture is not a photograph, it's more like a painting, where you have to vision and figure out what that's going to look like in 5 or 10 years. To me, the challenge you have as commissioners is, when you go from an accurate assessment in that first photograph to that painting, not only figuring out, okay, these are the issues, but y'all have the exceeding challenge of saying, okay, well, what issues do we address first? And with how much of our time, how much of our resources? So to me, our hope is to bring you a document that says, here's the community. And I think it's up to y'all to say, okay, where do we go first? Where do we put resources? Where do we put time? And that, to me, is a challenge. But I think it's something that legacy-wise can be a very important and beneficial part of your legacy this year.
Next to our financial responsibilities, I think this is the single most important thing that happens for all the above and aforementioned reasons. And I feel like we're in good hands with Jason and Ariel's help and RDC. And I agree with Mr. George, Commissioner Evans, that we need to just get the word out and express to the general public, being a stakeholder itself, just how important it is to be at this meeting.
Does it fit in this conversation that we're confident that all of our departments funding inspections and everything is business friendly as much as they can do, so that when new people come in, they're welcome with open arms? They don't have to jump through a bunch of unnecessary hoops or problem hoops. Are we working in those areas?
Yes, I think as it relates to our planning deposits, Jason said from the TRC standpoint and planning and zoning and the format that you're giving us through this comp plan helps to facilitate what you're asking us to do. Now, to drill down a little bit deeper as we get to actual review of plans, requirements on landscaping, entrances, and so forth, that is a little more detailed than what we would be getting into in the comprehensive plan. But it is certainly a message that has not been lost on the county and on those individuals that around that TRC table. Is that?
Yes, sir. I mean, to me, the goal would be, of course, to maintain an atmosphere of, you know, business-friendly, you know, consumer-friendly type of services. And then maybe as you drill down, the objective or the performance measure might be, okay, well, within the next 5 years, we're going to, you know, look at this particular division and look at these particular requirements that maybe you have heard of in some issues. So to me, the overall goal, I think, probably will be very general. But then the follow-up action steps are what you're talking about okay, what about this particular item? What about this particular area? And I will tell you that we certainly can improve, but this plan, maybe the next meeting, not the goals meeting, because that would probably be a general goal, maybe the short-term work program, those are the kind of action items, is where we get a little bit more specific. Not change this in your ordinance specific, but we need to address this area specific.
And Jason, in regards to the opportunity zones that we looked at in the past, how would this, I guess, play into that even further?
Sure.
We've already pursued.
Sir, in my opinion, and you may be able to challenge me with, you know, how those actually play out, what those look like at the end of the day. To me, the comp plan, it probably would fall under economic development because it's a tool to encourage economic development in certain areas of the community. And then what this plan would do is say, okay, are we ready to take the next step and really invest in this as a, you know, as a tool for economic development, or we want to investigate it. This plan probably would address it in a goal as far as saying we want to encourage economic development. Well, that's easy. But here's an action step of how we do that, is we investigate opportunities and we look at the investments necessary to say, do we want to bring this online? Is it worth the investment? So I would say, again, it's probably not a goal because that's more economic development. We would that's something we want to follow up. Probably an action step on that second meeting for the short-term work program to say, okay, this is an action item that, you know, is there enough consensus there to say we want to pursue this? Is there enough consensus to say we want to pursue the investment required to make this tool something the community can have as available for it right now? Because right now, the opportunity might be there, but certainly the infrastructure to say this is a real live benefit is not currently there. We've looked at it, but we've not said this is something we want to do and invest in and make sure we have this as something to offer some of those areas around the community.
These workshops, are they all available on Sebastian?
Commissioner, those are our plans. If we have to change locations, for example, if we get, you know, a tremendous amount of feedback on land use, for instance, we all know how much feedback we get when we start talking about what should this map show or where should it show it. We could have to move them maybe to the conference center, maybe the city annex, depending on the turnout. But right now, the plan is to have them all at the West Van Avenue location and all coincide with that planning commission work session.
I kind of see your analogy of going from the picture to the painting. Mm-hmm. I mean, wouldn't it be appropriate to say that, like, the background of the painting is the comprehensive plan? That's kind of where you got to start, and then you just layer forward until you get to.
Commissioner, you certainly don't have to, but I think it is better for us as a community and better for us as a government if our plans reflect our plans. Certainly, there might be reasons to, you know,
project max.
Exactly. I mean, certainly things are going to happen. It's like, okay, you know, if we can make this work, great. If not, okay, that was a good example of things you don't plan on, but you try to accommodate for by your investments in all that infrastructure. But my hope is that our plan truly reflects a direction so that when other people look at us, when the commissioners look at it, who might be here in future, you know, future commissions, that they know where that direction is and where we're headed. Certainly we could do, we could take the draft in there right now and say, this is good enough for us right now and be done with it. And that would be a reflection of 10 years ago. You know, in D.C. they would probably say thank you. They probably wouldn't give us a lot of holdup on it. But I don't think it would be really as effective as it should be for a community of our size and our quality if that plan didn't really reflect the direction that you thought the community should go in.
I'm just out of curiosity, are there things that you look back at in the original, not the original, but mm-hmm. the last major update to the comprehensive plan, are things that you're looking at now in comparison to where, I mean, are we on a path moving forward or
yes.
are things kind of jumping around?
We had
dramatic differences between then and now.
I don't see dramatic differences. To me, the most dramatic difference that if you could put it in, okay, Jason, what are major changes you expect? Number one is that common community vision document. That has not been done. So for us to have some staff at the regional commission that took the initiative to say, let's look at everybody else's plans and see where we're together. That to me is probably the most significant change. The other changes, especially.
Wait, can I stop here?
Yeah.
When you talk about other comprehensive plans,
yes.
Who all is required? Is it county or is it city and county or?
Every single local government, even though we have a joint plan because we plan jointly, every single local government has to have their own comprehensive plan. So even though our plan might be a joint plan between the county and the cities, the way DCA looks at this is, does Lyons County have a plan? Does Riverton have a plan? Does Lake Park have a plan? So every single government will be required to vote on this plan by the end of the year. So that'll be something that DCA requires of every single local government to have.
But right now, they hire Lake Park. They're not working on their own in isolation,
no,
on their own comprehensive plan.
We are all jointly using the regional commission as a clearinghouse to prepare our document. Is it very possible that at the end of the day, the county commission has XYZ changes and the city has, you know, ABC changes? It certainly is. But the overall focus that we've had probably for 20 to 25 years has been an effort of, can we get somebody together that truly reflects all of our interests? But when push comes to shove, it will be up to each individual municipality and the county governments to vote on what their particular final version is.
So we should fully expect to see the cities within our county taking an active role in this and
yes.
being at these workshops
yes.
and ensuring that
out of the gate, so to speak, that they're voicing their.
Absolutely. And I think based on previous experience, Lyons County gets it. The city of Austin, I think, gets it. Certainly some of their funding is strictly tied to specific word in this plan for housing and traffic. But the small municipalities, hey, Hira takes a pretty active role. Lake Park, Riverton, Dasher, they are not as active. I think they are aware. But certainly, you know, if you would make a phone call or send an email to some of the smaller cities to help encourage them to just be aware of this, we're going to reach out. They're going to work with Ariel regardless. So there's a common planner there. But ultimately, I think some of their participation would be helpful. At the end of the day, it is going to come to their desk.
And I assume you would be willing if we went to, for instance, if I wanted to go to the leadership in Hayhire, the
yes.
city of Hayhire, we could set that up and
sure.
just do a quick little.
Sure. No problem. And to me, you know, the city and the county, Valdosta and the county, are the only ones who have full-time planning staff. Hayhire uses Valdosta's planning staff. Lake Park, Riverton, Dasher really lean on the regional commission. And they have a relationship with Ariel now. So Ariel's not starting from scratch. He's been in the community. He's helped them with their various zoning cases, et cetera. But certainly, yes, I think those meetings will be beneficial. And again, it's, you know, would we be able to adopt something if we never hear from the smaller cities? We would. But is it as effective? Exactly. It's just not as effective. And I don't think the plan's quality is diminished if we don't really hear from them, like your constituents. Could we do it with everyone at this table and not hear from a single person? We could, but would it be as good of a plan if we do that? And the answer is no. That their perspective, their input, because that's why we have, you know, public hearings on rezoning cases, because they live out there. They might tell us something that we just flat out don't know because we're not as familiar with the area. That similar kind of value is also here with the conference.
I'm Jason, myself as well as Commissioner Evans, we, you know, we have a passion for the neighborhood area in the eastern part of the county. Mm-hmm. And I was just wondering, you know, how would we possibly turn something about development towards that direction? I know sure. we approached about the opportunity zone and so forth, but what would be a good way to perhaps word a goal towards, you know, development or some towards an area that's not incorporated?
To me, probably one of the biggest discriminators that we see for growth in certain areas of the county over others, and I'm saying this statement without, you know, without financial consideration, I'm just going to tell you the blanket statement, is the provision of water and sewer services. When you get to a level where you can upgrade to a community water system, and then the next upgrade is the community sewer system, that to me, when you look at those areas on that map and say, where is growth happening? Where is it not happening? Investment in infrastructure-wise, water and sewer, beyond water and sewer, you look at road status, with the Naylor area, I would say probably water and sewer services are something that are not present because of its location. They're probably a factor for that area growing more because right now you have Lake Lapaw, which certainly could be expanded and the county could put in a healthy amount of money to make sure that system is county worthy. But as a discriminator on that map, when you start to look at where is growth happening, where has it been, investment-wise, water and sewer and roads are the primary pieces to put in place to help, I think, spur on some of that activity. Beyond that, I would just leave you with another consideration of why we see some growth in areas and not in others is the schools. School system choice and school system district boundaries are a very real factor in where people choose to build and locate. And I think if we're not able to have an honest conversation about that here, then we are missing that aspect because that is a very real part of where we see growth is infrastructure, specifically roads, water, and sewer. But Jason, if you only pick one, I pick water and sewer. And then also because we have a basic backbone of roads that are paved and improved. And then the second part is schools have they possess a very large influence on where growth goes in Lyons County. And I mean that not only for Lyons County, I specifically mean as county commissioners to see how awesome.
In relationship to the Naylor or Lap Hall area, one of the biggest issues that we found in discussing development in that area is the availability of property, because so much of the property in that area is not available, or as by the owners of the state, it's not available for some type of industrial or economic development. It's Pine Tree, some people are comfortable with that, and they are profitable with that. Mm-hmm. So they're not interested in developing that in-between area from Naylor back in or from Valdosta towards Naylor.
Yes, sir. Remember, I mean, the Dollar General out there was a huge deal, and our particular location, first location for that Dollar General, when they looked at putting it closer into the main intersection, was deemed not available because of the particular property owner's request financially for how valuable they thought that property was. So Dollar General, very soon, said, well, that's fine, we'll just go a little bit outside your town center and locate there. And that was not without some opposition from the Naylor community, but I would like to believe that investment has been an asset for them, because it provides the people of Lake Lapahaw, the general area, with something besides driving 15 minutes into Valdosta. But that's a very, well, this picture is very real and effective where Dollar General located.
Can you talk about that?
Well, it's still a concern out here that it's a grant that we not community doors and attractive water. So we've been free. They didn't win. So 97% of them did not
Yes, sir, and I do have these, and I was hoping to get them in here in a dry area, and I will put them up for you during lunchtime, but we have prepared three maps for you, and what they really show is what did our zoning map look like 1 year ago, what did our zoning map look like today, and then where did those changes happen? So you can kind of see with a highlight where those various changes happen. And they are the three maps at the very end part of your book. I think part of the conversation for you as commissioners
is under the 2015-16 zoning.
So what this is just a highlight so you can see by location where our zoning changes over the last year happened. And you can see everything on there from that Project Max site, which was probably our most significant change, to the smaller changes. But it gives you some perspective of where is zoning already in place, where is zoning requesting to be changed. That is an indicator of growth and investment. And also, it just gives you a stamp in time, again, on where were we, where are we now, as we lead into conversations with the comp plan about where are we going. Do we like the way the zoning is reflecting the growth of the county? Did there need to be some widespread changes, et cetera? And I know something that Mr. Pritchard has helped us with as staff is with our monthly reporting, to make sure our monthly reporting is reflecting where some of these growth areas and where some of these changes are occurring. And to me, honestly, I think one of the things that limits that is honestly just the time that staff has currently with the resources we have to try to make sure we're reflecting that. A good amount of information for you to know where growth is happening. But certainly, I mean, our limitation right now is probably time. There are certain things we can show the commissioners. Here's where the subdivision, here's where plats, here's where subdivision plats are being recorded. Here's where property is being cut up. Here's where permits are being pulled. Here's where potential changes in value on properties are happening. We are capable of looking at those resources. For us, it's just right now. By now, it's a question of time and balance for some of our staff, and I say that with due respect. Certainly, y'all have known and have felt some of the pressure we've had. For example, over the last 2 months, we went straight from, literally finishing the MAZ. I haven't even fully wrapped that up yet because we went straight into Project Max, and trust me, I knew it was worth it. And then you go into budget and commission retreat, and all of a sudden, you've lost, 3 months of your time. where he would do some other extra studies like this. And oh, by the way, you've got four rezoning cases coming up on Tuesday. So certainly something from a planning standpoint is we, right now, we believe we are probably at a pace that is not sustainable.
That might be working already.
Well, he's working on additional help.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, literally, we have had a conversation where, what if we cut our hours so we can create some space for a part-time job? That way it doesn't involve a budget. Literally, these are the kind of things that we have talked about to try to allow for some time to come in there for a staff person just to be kind of a release valve. Because all of these are worthy things to spend your time on. But right now, with, you know, two plus people, we are operating at, we feel like, an unsustainable pace. And I say that because I know the commission likes, you know, a certain level of customer service that we do as staff. But some of these things where we can allocate growth and show growth in your areas, we feel like we can do, but with a limited amount of staff, we just need more lead time. You know, it takes us more time than, you know, a larger staff would. So, but yes, Mr. Pritchard, he's fully aware. He's aware, and they're aware of all the modifications we've done to try to work with the staff we have. But certainly that's something for us that, that is on our radar, because, you know, compared to the, you know, $250,000 or $350,000 we need the regional commission to do our jobs with, you know, five people, and we split that up, brought that back in, and ran that down, and I think that was a good thing. And it saved the taxpayers certainly a large chunk of money when we felt like, let's bring it in-house and do this efficiently. We are starting to get to a point where it's starting to unravel a little bit with what we want to do and what we can do with the people.
We've already met that threshold. We're not beginning to.
Yeah. You're on the
other side of it. I am. I should have started this 2 years ago, but I started last year and didn't do as good of a job as I should have. But certainly we have tried to maintain, and I think y'all can see that. But when you get to a point of, you know, your customer service almost getting unsatisfactory, you just start, you know, you really start to say, okay, you know, if for some reason, because you have, you know, one or two other budget requests, if for some reason this is not the year for planning or engineering, I understand. But certainly we need to do something different, maybe in terms of priorities, where we can start to ratchet back and figure out how can we do this with what we're being asked to do with the staff.
It'd be okay, Jay.
I just want to give y'all an accurate picture of, we want to help, we want to do a good job, but it's to a point now where these past couple years where it's kind of like, okay, you know, help is coming, but we just don't know what format looks like yet.
Well, Jason is willing to take on any and every additional task. He's handling street lighting, and he's staying on top of that. He chairs the TRC, as y'all know. And when this Project Max came up the other day, he was along with Mike Fletcher and Steve Stowley, the ones, and Carmel.
Yes, sir.
They were calling and said, we've got to meet. We got to meet right now. We don't have any lead time. So they just started putting everything down. Mm-hmm. So, go ahead, Jeremy.
That's fine. And of course, I just was going to reiterate Mr. Weisenbaker had mentioned about, you know, being business friendly, and again, that's directly related to customer service, and planning and zoning is the front line. I mean, that's where everybody comes initially to get anything started in our community. That's the first people they talk to. So, you know, I'm glad that we have these conversations.
Yeah.
Because we as commissioners, we can get to a point of where we just say, well, you know, it's going to happen. You know, I mean, they're going to give us the information that we need to be able to make a good decision and then move forward. But reality is that at the same time, we want to be sure that the other pressures that we're asking for on issues of rezoning and those sort of things don't come at the expense of customer service. And so again, it's good to have that conversation, and I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. It's great. That support is very, very very welcome, and we appreciate that. That helps when we're in those times, we do feel appreciated and supported.
I think he, what he's trying to say is he appreciates the help more than the pat on the back.
I think it's always strong to pat on the back. You know, I didn't want him to go out and jump in front of a train.
It's not at that level, but you're right. And you know, I mean, it's, you know, running the business, okay, if you're Jason, if you have four zoning cases and that takes up this much time, but something else has to short. And normally the shorts right now are text amendments get shorted, except for the MAZ, we just did it. But text amendments get shorted. Tax lighting, we like to do a better job with tax lighting because we just feel like through auditing, we'll be able to save, you know, large chunks of money when we feel like we can pull a team together and look at what we're doing. And then also text and then subdivision plats. Our surveyors are patient with us. You probably don't hear complaints very often, but ultimately, the surveyors are those customers. That's an aspect of our job that you maybe not hear about as much. But certainly, you know, when those things happen, they are normally the ones. Those are the three areas that wait. Rezoning cases normally can't wait. Text amendments wait, special tax lighting waits, and subdivision plats wait. And that's where, the customer service standpoint, they wait, but then you get some where you're like, yes, sir, I'm sorry for the delay. How else can we help you?
Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Do you have a map that shows all the parcels that have been rezoned in the last 10 years?
We can work on that.
We have. I don't spend a lot of time on this.
I just asked you if you had one already.
That is fixing that for two people.
for maps like this, certainly at the speed we would reach out to Valley. Who has been a very helpful program for us and would say, Valor, you know, can you get us a map that shows XYZ in 10 years? And I think the answer is yes, it's probably just a matter of time. But we've been digitally tracking rezoning cases for the entire community, including the cities, since 1996. So we have that information. Again, it's just, you know, time and resources to get it. But we can certainly get that.
Have you thought about start early instead?
I will, and I might go a little bit too far here, Commissioner, but Mr. Pritchard was a big reason why I'm now working for Lowndes County. And when I worked for the Regional Commission before I came to Lowndes County, when I first started, right around when, literally, I think I started with the county 1 month before the ULDC got here, for probably about the first 2 years, I worked an incredible, incredible amount. And the fruit of that was I actually almost lost the sight in my right eye because I developed shingles. And so you can imagine me going into my doctor's office and be like, you got what? I mean, shingles go on your roof, what are you talking about? So literally, it was a check for me, not only in my work life, but my personal life as well. Be like, Jason, you can't live like this. So in my planning career, I think what you will find is a planner who exceeded how hard he was supposed to work, and then probably a season where I did not work as hard as I could have because I just was so hesitant because I didn't want to have health effects. And now I think what you're having is that pendulum is now swung to, okay, now I'm not as naive as I once was, and I'm getting to the point where I need to ask for some help because the activity we're seeing, it's a good problem to have. We're seeing this problem because we're having so many requests and so much growth. But personally, yes, sir, I have definitely considered modifying work hours, but I've been burned once before, and I don't really want to go down that road again.
Well, and he's got an overachieving wife who they will work probably around the clock.
She,
poor kid.
Yes, we want to be
Clark's in charge.
Want to have a good marriage. Want to have a good family. Might not know is I also help with the youth at our church, and so something in addition to this, trying to balance all that, is certainly on my radar, and I try to do a good job of balancing those things. But I can tell you that there was one point in my life where I certainly went overboard on work, and God put a roadblock in my way that was a good thing. It was a good thing for me to have that attitude check, because I didn't need to be living at that pace, nor could I sustain it.
Well, Adam County, thank you.
Yes, sir.
For what the job that you do right now, and, you know, I'm not the one to let that sort of stuff get by. I try to do that as often as I can, because I do sincerely mean it. And then I certainly recognize hard work and efforts, and I recognize those talents as being an employer in this community. And so it's extremely important. And if you ever get tired of Joe Pritchard, come see me.
Sir,
I will do some planning.
I will hear about that comment later. I will hear about that comment later, sir. And I would just encourage y'all. I hear your support and your praise, and it is heard, and I'm very thankful for that. I would say there's a crew there that you don't get to see as often, with Trini, sure, and Deborah, and Sharon, potentially even Carmella, even though Carmella's there most of the time. They are true frontline employees, and so if you happen to be in the building and want to stop by just to tell them something like that, I think it'll be well received, because certainly they are a hardworking part of this team that doesn't always get the front door recognition that Carmella and I might.
Well, I would like to think, and you're right, you know, when you do acknowledge the fact that a particular department head is, you know, doing a great job, that really, to me, goes as far as that department head's staff as well, and that whole team that does whatever they do. So, again, it is that team effort. And, of course, I know you have many teams within a big team, and it all just kind of, it works. And what I've seen is it's about as efficient as anything I've witnessed. You do a great job.
Thank you all very much. I appreciate the opportunity. I know you have 10 other people who can be filling this spot right now.
That's something under. Is that Grace?
Oh, yeah. Done. It's a good time. Got it.